Bibles to, where should we start? Let's go to John 14. John 14 and 16. And we've been talking, Pastor and I have had a very busy week, but a fun week. We went and visited some pastor friends of ours, had a pastor's day up in Spokane, Washington. That was fun. And then we came back, we're here for Wednesday, and then we turned around on Thursday and went back to Tacoma, Washington for our regional, with Rhema, our regional director, his 70th birthday was yesterday, so we went up to celebrate that, and that was fun. Got back this morning, and we are ready to go. Amen? In just a second. We were serenaded last night, yes. It was not fun. Praise the Lord. Are you talking about what I'm talking about? Yeah. Oh, praise the Lord. We were in a noisy hotel. Okay. So, I'm going to talk to you, I probably won't say anything too much different than what Pastor's been saying about being led by the Spirit. I might have a little bit different, you know, way of showing it to you, but it's so important that we have a relationship with the Holy Spirit. We understand who He is. We understand what He sounds like. We understand what the ways that He directs us. And the reason for this series is to help you. How many of you know we all need help? Amen? Because sometimes we think, oh, I get that, I've heard that, oh, I get it. But we really, I don't know, it's something that you have to work on, it's something that you have to cultivate, it's something that you have to learn who the Holy Spirit is and how He's leading you and how He talks. And He will always talk in line with the Word. And you should already know that by now. If you're new here tonight, thank you for coming. Maybe you'll hear something new that you haven't heard before. Hopefully, we can help you. Amen. Let's just pray as we open up here. Father, we just thank You for opening our ears to hear tonight, showing us things that maybe we haven't seen before. Show us how to apply the things that we hear tonight. We thank You for revelation. We thank You, Holy Spirit, You live big on the inside of us. And we thank You that You are increasing us, our awareness of You, and You are leading us day by day through the inward witness and sometimes just speaking to us. We thank You for it in Jesus' name. So John 14, 16 says this. I'm going to read this out on the Amplified just because I like the way it says it. It says, "And I will ask the Father, and He will give you another comforter, counselor, helper, intercessor, advocate, strengthener, and standby, that He may remain with you forever." And this was Jesus talking to His disciples because He was getting ready to leave, but He's saying, hey, I'm not going to leave you by yourself. You're going to have another one just like Me. And then the Amplified, I love, if you look this up in the Greek, all these words bear out. So, and then verse 17, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, welcome, take into its heart, because it does not see Him or know and recognize Him. But you know and recognize Him, for He lives with you constantly and will be in you. And then flip over a couple of chapters to John 16. John 16, verse 7 says, however, I am telling you nothing but the truth when I say it is profitable, good, expedient, advantageous for you that I go away. Because if I do not go away, the Comforter, and again, Counselor, Helper, Advocate, Intercessor, Strengthener, and Standby, will not come to you into close fellowship with you. But if I go away, I will send Him to you to be in close fellowship with you, in you. With you, in you, and with you. He's in you, and He's with you. And you need to be aware of Him. And you need to know when He's leading you. And you need to know when He's talking to you. And He is certainly well able to speak up if you're in a dangerous situation or you're in a situation where you need Him to alert you. He's well able to speak up loud and clear, crystal clear, actually, if you're paying attention. And it will keep you out of harm's way. If you're listening. Amen. Now, I'm going to give you some keys. We could say keys, steps, points, whatever. And as I was thinking about this scripture, I don't even know how I found this. I don't know how I found it, but I'm going to share it. And it's Luke 21. You can jump over there. Luke 21, verse 34. I love my Bible. I love the Word of God. I'm so glad I'm saved. I love Jesus. I love the Father. I love the Holy Ghost. Amen. I'm just glad to be saved, aren't you? You know, the world is waxing darker and darker, but not us. We're going to hold fast to our integrity. There are some very clear lines of the way we're supposed to be living. And unfortunately, a lot of Christians have very gray lines and do things that are going against their heart and convincing themselves that it's okay. And it's actually not okay. If they'd pay attention, the Holy Ghost would be telling them, you know, I'm just going to say this, and maybe you drink, and maybe you're new here tonight and you don't have an issue with that. But, you know, I never had anybody have to tell me that drinking was bad. I never had anybody preach it to me. I actually went to a Baptist church at the time, many years ago. I got saved, was going to a Baptist church, and a head deacon invited us over for dinner. And at this time, my husband had an issue with drinking, and I was looking for answers. And he invited us over for dinner. It was a very nice dinner, but they served wine at that dinner. And I thought, oh, because I was already feeling this little, like, maybe I shouldn't be drinking. I was getting convicted. You know what I'm saying? Just getting convicted. And they served wine. And because it was a head deacon, and actually it was over the Sunday school, and I was teaching with this man. I was where I learned my first, you know, Bible story was under him in the first grade class with five-year-olds. But it was kindergarten. But anyway, they served wine. And I remember thinking, oh, so this is okay, because they were drinking, you know, serving alcohol. And I thought, oh, okay. And I came from a family that drank alcohol all the time, so I didn't really have anything to judge it. I just was feeling like maybe I shouldn't, you know what I'm saying? And then we moved to Klamath Falls, and I started getting closer and closer to God, and the closer I got to God, the more I started feeling less comfortable with drinking alcohol. In fact, I started feeling very convicted about drinking alcohol. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? And I had a neighbor that used to come and visit with me and talk to me about Jesus, and I would be standing at my picture window, and I'd have a glass of wine or a glass of beer or something, you know, and I'd see her coming, and I'd run and hide it. And she never said anything to me. Nobody ever said anything to me. I never heard it preached, nothing. It was just something that was going on in here. And that's what you have to pay attention to. What is going on inside here? Nobody preached to me, nobody told me, but I made a decision at some point in those early years. I made a decision, I'm done drinking alcohol. Then the test came. So family came over, my mom makes a Bloody Mary, vodka, tomato juice, makes a drink, Christmas morning. Brings it to me, sets it in front of me. And now I have a choice. I'd already made this decision. I'd actually made it about a month before that. I just made a decision to quit drinking. And so she sets it in front of me, and now I have a choice. And I went like this. And this is in front of my family. I've always drank, you know, served wine at every meal, and, you know, it wasn't really an issue, except for my mother ended up being an alcoholic. That was a problem. And so did my dad, and got Alzheimer's, and anyway, and so I was sitting there with that drink, and I just thought, no, I'm not going to drink this. And I walked over to the sink, and I poured it down the sink. That was it. I'd made my decision. I've never been tempted. That was it. And that was in 1980. Haven't ever had alcohol since then. So let's read this. Luke 21. That was free. That wasn't in my notes. Luke 21. All right, but, let's see, I'm starting to, Okay, let's read it in the New King James, and I'm going to read it in the Message. Verse 34. But take heed to yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and the cares of this life, and that day come on you unexpectedly. For it will come as a snare on all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch therefore, and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. Listen to this in the Message. But be on your guard. Don't let the sharp edge of your expectation get dulled by parties and drinking and shopping. Otherwise, yeah, speaking to me too, I know. Otherwise, that day is going to take you by complete surprise, spring on you suddenly like a trap, for it's going to come on everyone everywhere at once. So whatever you do, don't go to sleep at the switch. Pray constantly that you will have the strength and wits to make it through everything that's coming and end up on your feet before the Son of Man. How many of you know we're living in a day and an age that Jesus could certainly come back at any time? And I think a lot of believers are going to be caught unawares. They're not going to be ready. And they're going to be surprised. They're going to still be standing here, sitting here. You know what I mean? Okay, so I'm going to give you some points in how to train your spirit. You know, Pastor talked last week about being rain trained. What does that mean? He used a scripture out of Proverbs. Do you remember what scripture that was?
4:18.
Proverbs 4:18. What's it saying, Natalie? Give it to now. She's got to go find it. Okay. Well, anyway, it was talking about being rain trained. And you know, when you have a, how many of you are horsey people? Have horses? Okay. So I'm not. Don't. So this is the way I understand it. Okay. So if a horse that is rain trained, if you kind of you teach them that with just the slightest little nudge, the slightest tug on their neck with the rein, and they'll turn. Is that right? And so then they're rein trained. They just, is that right? Little horsey girl, yes? And you take the what? A what? His neck rein. And you kind of, and if they're rein trained, they will just move wherever, and they won't resist you. If they're not rein trained, I would imagine they would kick up their heels and buck you off and be naughty horses, like my neighbor's horses that I used to live. I grew up with horses next door. And you could get on them, and they'd buck you off, and the kids would all go out there and rile them all up. It was terrible. But anyway, because they were mean. One time, one came over the fence and bit my mom right here on the shoulder, just took a chunk out of her shoulder and bit her and kind of threw her. Yeah. Anyway, my parents did not like those horses. But they weren't rein trained. They weren't trained. They were kind of wild. But if you train a horse and they've got that rein on, all you've got to do is just gently nudge it and he'll turn. He'll go wherever you want him to go. And that's the scripture. Did you find it, Natalie?
Yeah, Psalm.
What is it? Let's go look at it. Psalm 32. 32. 8. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will guide you with my eye. Yeah, here it is. Do not be like the horse or like the mule, which have no understanding, which must be harnessed with bit and bridle, else they will not come near you. And so when you're rein trained, you're sensitive. And we're to be rein trained by the Holy Ghost. That means when he tells us to go this way, we go. Or if he says that way, we go. And Pastor's been talking and teaching us about being led by him, just like you would take a horse with the reins and lead him. And so what number one is, keep your spirit clean and clear. If you want to be led by the Spirit, you need to keep your spirit clean and clear. And I kind of want to do a demonstration, and I'm going to need some volunteers. This is what the word, in Romans 8:14, it says, for as many as are, help me, led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Okay, so the word led there is the Greek word ago, which is probably pronounced ago, which is the picture of someone gently leading someone else. This means the Spirit will lead us, but we must extend our hearts and hands to Him first, for without our cooperation, He cannot guide us anywhere. So I need some volunteers. Nate, stand up. Because I need somebody tall. Okay, Shreya, Autumn, you three girls, Joe, Jason, Sandrina. Okay, just a second. Because you're mean to me half the time, so I'm just paying you back. Here, now you need to sit down so I can do this. Okay? Okay, so when you're led by the Spirit, can you see anything?
Me?
Yeah.
No.
Okay. You sure?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Don't mess my hair up.
I'm not. It's fine. Okay. Okay. You come over here. Okay, just a second. And you stand about right there. Okay. Stand there. Stand over here. Okay. Get down on your hands and knees. That's it. Okay. So, the Holy Spirit, go ahead and stand up. So your job, turn around. Can you see anything?
I'm dizzy easily already.
You dizzy easily? Okay, so your job, don't look.
I'm not looking, it's falling down.
Okay. Okay, so your job is to follow my instructions. Okay?
Got it.
Can you do that? Okay.
Rambo.
Okay. Go forward 5 steps.
You're going to bump me into it. I trust the Holy Ghost a little bit more.
Turn right. Other right. Go forward. Go forward. Just go forward. Go forward. Go forward. Put your hands down. Put your hands down. You need to trust me. Go forward one more step. One more. Come this way. Follow my voice. Come this way.
There's speakers. Where's your voice?
I'm over here. Come this way. Sideways. 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 Stop. Take a big step over.
Over where?
Just over. Come.
Well, left or right?
Straight.
Forward or back.
Straight. Straight. Big step. Big step. Big step. Big step.
Did I just step on a person?
Lift up your other leg. Lift up your other leg. Okay, go forward. Go forward. Just start walking forward. Walking forward. Walking forward. Walking forward, stop, stop. One more step, don't look. One more step, turn right. Straight. Straight, good, good, good. Okay, let's go faster. Come on, follow me, you're fine.
Where am I going?
Following.
I can't see.
Just you're keep it. Here, I'll help you. I'll be your helper.
Thank you.
Walk fast, walk fast. Okay, big, big step. Okay, one more step. Stop, stop, stop. Okay, big, big, big step. Big step, big step. Bigger, bigger, bigger. Bigger, bigger, bigger. Good job. Okay, go straight. Go straight, go straight, go straight, go straight, go straight, go straight. I'm not going to have you get hurt. Just trust me. Go straight, go straight. Good job. Good job. Okay, turn right. Turn. No fair, no touching anything. Keep coming. Turn right. Nope. You big chicken. Okay, sidestep, 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 left, left. Sidestep, sidestep, left, 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 left. Go forward, go forward, go forward, go forward, go forward. Sit down. Sit.
It's a boy?
Sit down.
It's Kevin.
How do you know? You're a terrorist. Good job. Give him a hand. You know, we think it's easy to follow instructions, but we're kind of like that with the Holy Ghost. When he's given instructions and he's telling us what to do, we're like, are you sure? Are you sure? Are you sure? And we question and we wonder, and sometimes we argue, and sometimes we kind of do our own thing. And it's so important that we're learning. Thank you, Pastor Nate. It's so important that we're learning on the inside. You know, we will miss it. You will miss it. That's how we learn. We miss it. But then get back up and do it again and say, okay, well, I missed it that time, but I'm not going to miss it next time. And get that determination in your mind and in your heart that you're going to follow him. So number one was what? Keep your spirit clean and clear. Psalm 101 says, I will sing of your love. This is the NLT. I will sing of your love and justice, Lord. I will praise you with songs. I will be careful to live a blameless life when you come. When will you come to help me? I will lead a life of integrity in my own home. I will refuse to look at anything vile and vulgar. I hate all who deal crookedly. I will have nothing to do with them. I will reject perverse ideas and stay away from every evil. I had a conversation with somebody yesterday, and they were trying to explain this song. And I'm not going to say it because I have a feeling some of you would probably know it, but I did not know this song. And they were like, yes, you know it, you know it, you know it. I was like, no, I don't know it. There were other people there, and they're all saying, oh, you know this song. You know it. I know you know it. It's all over the place. Everybody sings it. And I'm like, I don't know it. And so they got it on, and they were determined that I knew the song. They got it on their little, you know, iPhone and held it up to my ear. And I'm like, nope, I don't know it. They're like, what's wrong with you? And so one of them said, don't you ever listen to secular music? And I went, nope, I don't. I don't. Do you watch secular movies? Not very often. Do you do anything secular? No, I don't. I live a life that's set apart for God, and you should too. You put, there's so much, oh my gosh, there's so much trash on TV, and what it's doing is desensitizing us. When you're watching killing and cussing and all kinds of sexual stuff, and you're watching, you're exposing that to yourself and your children, what do you think you're introducing to your kids and to your families? We have to be careful, not just our kids, we have to be careful about what we're putting inside of us. If you want to have a spirit that is sensitive and tender to God, you need to be saturated in him, not in the world. And I just, you know, maybe I'm different. Maybe we're different. I'm sure we are. But I would rather have the anointing of God. I would rather have the power of God. I would rather see people miraculously healed like we've seen all the time than to know some silly song that everybody else knows and they're singing it all over the place. I don't want that life. I left that life. I used to have that life. I didn't like that life. Yeah. I like the life I have now. And according to the word, we are not to be like the world. We are not to get our fellowship from the world. We are to be set apart. And yeah, we might be a little different. We might be called extreme. Oh, if I had a family member tell me this one time, and he said, you're serving a different Jesus than I am. I was like, I am? Really? Well, 20, 30 years later, yep, I am. And I won't tell you the rest of the story, but it's pretty ugly. But I'm fine. I like the Jesus I'm serving. I'm serving the one that's in the Bible. How about you? I'm serving the one that still heals today. How about you? I'm serving the one that provides for us in miraculous ways. How about you? I'm serving the one that forgave me of my sins. How about you? That's the Jesus I'm serving. So be it. Amen. So I will not... Let's go back to this. I will refuse to look at anything vile and vulgar. I hate all who deal crookedly. I will have nothing to do with them. I will reject perverse ideas and stay away from every evil. I will not tolerate people who slander their neighbors. I will not endure conceit and pride. I will search for faithful people to be my companions. How many of you know you need faithful people that are your companions? You know, young people, don't get your friendship from the world. You find people that love God, are serving God, and living a godly lifestyle to be your companions if you want to make it. Amen? Only those who are above reproach will be allowed to serve me. I will not allow deceivers to serve in my house, and liars will not stay in my presence. My daily task will be to ferret out the wicked and free the city of the Lord from their grip. The Living Bible, Psalm 101. Again, Romans 8:14. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. John 16:13. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you. You know, when we went to... Pastor and I had the privilege. It was the most incredible trip we've ever taken, and we would love to do it again. But Tony Cook took a tour group to Greece and Turkey, and we started out in Venice, and we boarded a ship, and we were on a ship with other Christians. It was a Christian ship, like a tour. What are they called? A cruise ship, and it was just awesome. We went into Greece. We went into Turkey. We visited Paul's second journey, everywhere Paul went. So we went to many different places. We went to Ephesus, and a lot of us, you've heard. We went to Athens, Corinth, Philippi, Pergamum, Antioch, Thessaloniki. It's not called Thessalonica. It's called Thessaloniki. We went to the Isle of Patmos, where the book of Revelation was written. We went to Sardis, and we went to Ephesus. We were on the streets of Ephesus, and where Timothy was killed, and where Paul, we got to sit in this big, what's that called? That big auditorium thing. Yeah, the amphitheater, where Paul was being accused of all kinds of different stuff. We got to sit in there. It was the most fascinating trip. But we had a tour guide that went with us. And, you know, we were on a ship, then we get off the ship and we get on these buses, and we had a woman tour guide and we had a male tour guide. And they were very knowledgeable of the region. And so they had speakers, and they were talking to us every place they would go. They would just tell us all about what was happening in this region, what had happened. And of course, it wasn't really from a biblical perspective. We got that from Tony Cook. So we had two different guides on this trip. And the lady guide was a little bit annoying, because she kept wanting to talk about all these gods, because they worshipped a lot of gods there. And that's why Paul began his journey. He was preaching the gospel. He was telling the truth of the gospel. And then we had Tony Cook, our Reverend Tony Cook, who's been here and was one of our instructors at Rhema. And he was so well-versed on what actually the biblical account of what had taken place. And without that guidance, We wouldn't know where we were. We wouldn't know what we were looking at, because it's all in ruins. It's being rebuilt, but it's all in ruins. And we would go very, very long distances, like 3 and 4 bus hour drives to get from one place to another. But it was so fascinating. And being in this foreign country, if we had just gotten off the ship and just landed by ourselves and been in, we wouldn't have known where to go. We wouldn't have known what to do. We wouldn't have any insight, either side of it. We just wouldn't have known without that guide. That guide was so important to educate us and to help us and to teach us about all these biblical places where great things had happened back many, many years ago. And so I was thinking about that as I was looking about this, because the Holy Spirit wants to be your guide throughout life. And He's really guiding you every single day. The thing is we're not always aware, and Pastor has said this, we're not always aware that He is guiding us, but He is guiding us. And I believe someday God's going to open our eyes, maybe when we're in heaven, and we're going to see, Pastor says this oftentimes, all the ditches we missed, all the bad things that could have happened, all the tragic things that could have happened that we missed because we were paying attention to Him, and He just like I led Pastor Nate around, He just kind of averted us around these obstacles, but we didn't even really know it. We weren't really aware of it. We're just following Him and doing what He tells us to do, and so we're always safe. And you know, just the other day, I was just thinking how blessed we are. We're just so blessed. I'm so blessed. Pastor, our kids, our family, we're so blessed. We're not sick. We don't have any disease. We have a nice home. We have a great church. Our people are wonderful. We just came off of a great conference where tons of women were delivered and ministered to and healed and set free from all kinds of stuff. And I'm just so blessed to be a part of what God is doing on this earth. And all that has come because we have paid attention to Him. And I don't expect that to change in the next 20, 30, 40 years, however many years we have left on this earth. I don't expect that to change. I expect us to have all our faculties. I expect us to be healthy. I expect us to be trim and young-looking and not all, you know, with some kind of disease and all decrepit. Why? Because we're following as best as we can. We're following the Holy Ghost every single day. And He is going to lead us into the paths of righteousness. He's going to lead us into blessing. He's going to lead us into wealth and health and everything good. He's not going to lead us into a ditch if we're paying attention, if we're listening, if we're cued in. And He's always sending us signals. He's always sending. And the best way to train yourself is in prayer. You know, you need to have a prayer life. You need to pray in the Holy Ghost. If you're not filled with the Holy Ghost, which means you speak in heavenly language. If you're not filled with the Holy Ghost, you need to get filled with the Holy Ghost. And then you need to exercise your spirit by praying in other tongues. Just the other day, I shared this at prayer clinic, and I shared it with the women at conference, but I'll share it with you guys. We were in here praying, and it was pre-service prayer. Two different things happened. One was I was just praying away, and all of a sudden, I just looked up, and it was with my spirit, and this isn't weird. It maybe sounds weird, but it wasn't weird. It was very real. I just looked up. I had my eyes closed, but I looked up, and I saw a whole tons of angels, angelic beings standing, not in the church. They were like up above in this circular around our church, like surrounding the church. And they were all standing. They were standing shoulder to shoulder, and I couldn't tell how deep they were. I could only see like the front row, and they were standing shoulder to shoulder, and they had something like a sword. Couldn't see it really clearly. And they were not, I dressed up like a Roman soldier at conference, and that is not what I saw. And it was not my imagination. It was not. I saw in the spirit realm, and I saw this angelic host, this army, standing there, standing guard. over our church. And it was awesome. It was awesome. And then the other thing that happened was I was praying in the spirit, pre-service prayer, just praying away, and I began to pray out stuff for next year, for next year's conference. You know why? Because the Holy Spirit shows us things to come. And I knew what I was doing. And before that, I'd had this thought, I don't know what I'm going to preach next year. I have no idea what I would preach next year because of our theme and overflow. And I'm like, man, what would I ever preach? I had that thought. And then here God just started having me. He showed me a picture of what, a demonstration of what I would be doing next year, this year. He shows. He'll pray through you. And that's one way of connecting with Him is praying in the Holy Ghost. It clears things up that you can't see with your natural eyes and you don't know with your natural mind. It's spiritual. It's spiritual. Go over to 1 Corinthians, just a second. Thank you, Jesus. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And let's start with verse 6. However, we speak wisdom among those who are mature, yet not the wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the ages for our glory, which none of the rulers of this age knew. For had they known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. How many of you know that's true? But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love Him. But God has revealed, and revealed means like take the cover off. You know, like there's things that we are called to do that you just don't know yet because you haven't prayed that thing out. But God has revealed them to us through His Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. Verse 13, these things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches us, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know him, because they are spiritually discerned. But he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is rightly judged by no one. For who has known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. It is so important that you are connected to God's Spirit and you are praying out of your spirit. That means praying in other tongues out of your spirit. It doesn't come from your natural mind. But God does reveal things to your natural mind as you pray. And it's so important that you are praying out His plan, His perfect plan for your life. So many people just bumble through life and they don't know where they're going or what they're supposed to be doing for the kingdom of God. And they're just trying this and trying that, and this doesn't make them happy and that doesn't make them happy, so let's try this. No, that doesn't work either, so let's try this. If you'll pray, God will show you the way. He will direct your paths and He will teach you what to do, what the next step is. Now, for us, he never just does the whole thing. He doesn't show you the whole plan, but He'll show you the next step. And it's your job to follow Him. It's your job to pay attention when He tells you do this, do that. Sometimes it just starts with everyday things. You know, when I was younger and learning to listen, God began to tell me every time I go into a restroom, a public restroom, to pick up the toilet paper. Toilet paper, paper towels. You know what public restrooms are like. Do you? What are they like? You know, junk on the floor. They're gross. Who wants to touch that? Not me. And I was like, seriously? But I would do it. I would get a clean piece of toilet paper, and I would scoop it all up, and I'd throw it away. And then if there was toilet paper towels all over, I would get a clean paper towel, and I would just pick them all up, and I would throw them away. And he did that for quite a while. Quite a while. Now, you know what? I still do that today, but he doesn't nudge me to do it. I just do it because that's what he has always had me do in the early years. And it was what I didn't understand was that was part of my training, to learn to listen to him. It wasn't anything. This is one way, you know, usually your flesh goes, ew, I don't want to do that. No, nasty, yuck. Well, it's a good indication that, you know, sometimes we go, was that me or was that God? Well, if it was you, you would want to do it. It's when you're arguing against this inclination to go do something, it's like, oh, get a clue. This isn't you. It's the Holy Ghost on the inside of you trying to get you to move on something. He's training us. He's getting us rain trained. Come on, come on, come on. And sometimes we're just flat stubborn. We're like, no, I don't want to do that. No, I don't want to go. I don't want to go to church on Saturday night. I don't want to go. I don't want to go. I don't want to do that. I don't want to go. I don't want to go. And he's like, come on, come on. And he's trying to train us. And, you know, at some point, now I found this out, at some point he'll leave you alone if you keep ignoring him. He'll quit bugging you. But then you better be careful, because you might not hear him when you need to hear him. So we need to be cluing in. We need to be taking those cues when they're coming. We need to be sensitive and keep our hearts sensitive. Amen? And in that sensitivity is keeping your conscience clear. Keeping your conscience clear. Acts 24:16, Paul said this, "This being so, I myself always strive to have a conscience without offense towards God and man." So we're keeping our spirit clear, but now we got to keep our conscience clear, which is connected to your spirit. So what do I mean by that? Well, what's convicting you? What are you dealing with? Like I shared that story about my drinking. I was so convicted about that. You know how I knew? Because when this neighbor would come over, I would run and hide my drink. I didn't want her to see it. She never preached to me about it. She never talked to me about it. But this conviction, and actually, I remember going, oh my gosh, would you go away? Quit coming to my house. I felt like that. My flesh felt like that because I liked my little drink. And I didn't like this neighbor coming over and talking to me about God's stuff. I did really, but my flesh didn't. So I'd run and I'd hide it and then I'd act all, except for I was kind of loopy, you know, I was. Anyway, but it was the Holy Ghost on the inside of me that was convicting me. What is convicting you? Pay attention to that. What are you doing that you're getting that little nudge on the inside that makes you uncomfortable? Good. Pay attention to that. Don't ignore it. Cue into it. Oh, no, I don't want to quit watching that show. Oh, I don't want to turn off that secular music. No, I like listening to it. That's right, your flesh likes listening to it. But it's not good for you. A lot of you know my Dr. Pepper story. I was getting convicted about drinking Dr. Pepper. What's wrong with Dr. Pepper? I gave up booze. Why can't I drink Dr. Pepper? Oh, the Holy Ghost would convict me. And he would, every time I would lift it up to my mouth, I would hear, don't drink that. And then I'd stop for a while. And then I'd go back to drinking again. And then I'd stop for a while. So this process went on a couple years. And to make a long story short, one day, got the Dr. Pepper out, poured it into my cup, lifted it up to my lips, and there was no voice correcting me. Silence, nothing. And it scared me. Because I know what the scriptures say. I'm not dumb. I'm not ignorant according to the word, what the word says. And I knew I had just hardened my heart. Because he had been telling me, he's so gracious. He'd been telling me and telling me and telling me. And then I would justify it and go back to it again. And then he'd tell me and tell me and tell me. And I would justify it. I'd quit. And then I'd justify it, go back to it again several, several times. Until finally the day came when there was no voice of correction. That was the day I decided, I'm done. No more. Not playing this game. Took my Dr. Pepper bottles out of the fridge and dumped them all down the sink. Haven't had it since. Keep your conscience clear. Number three, repent. Repent. Turn. If your conscience is bothering you, you have to turn away from that. Repent means turning around and going the other way. It's making a decision. When you repent, so often I taught this to the youth. So often we say, I'm sorry, God, I'm sorry. Put a Band-Aid on it, I'm sorry, and then go right back and keep doing what we're doing. That is not true repentance. True repentance is turning away from that, saying no, and going the other direction. I am not going back to that. That is true repentance. And we need to keep a repentant heart. An unrepentant heart will harden your heart and will keep you from hearing God's voice and keep you from understanding His leading. His leading of you. You won't get it. Because you'll be all bottled up in here and all confused. So you want to pay attention to that. It's not comfortable. None of us like it. Nobody likes to be convicted. We don't like it when pastor's preaching and he starts reading your mail and he gets right in front of you and he's looking right at you and you think he knows everything that you're doing, which he actually doesn't. But you think he does because he's inspired by the Holy Ghost to say the things he's saying, and he's got unction to come and stand right in front of you and look at you in the eye and say some things, and you want to, I know, I've been there, you guys, where you want to crawl under the chair, or you want to run out the door. That stupid church, I hate that church, I'm never coming back there. It's your flesh. It's your flesh, and your flesh doesn't like it when your toes get stepped on. But like one famous preacher says, put your big boy or your big girl pants on. Come on, we're grown-ups. We're not little kids. We're not playing little kid games. We're not back in the preschool, right? So when that conviction comes, it's time for you to wake up. Wake up. Wake up. That conviction is there to help you. God put that on the inside of you and me. It's there to help you. It's there to strengthen your core. You know how important it is to strengthen your core? Mine needs to be stronger, I know, because I find myself doing this. I hate that. It's like stand up straight. Oh, yeah. Next thing you know, I'm doing that again because my core isn't strong. Trying to do that 21-day fixing, oh my gosh, it about kills me. I have to do the fat lady one all the time. I can't do, because they've got a bigger lady on there that does the modified, and I have to do hers because I can't do it because I'm not strong enough. That's in the natural. I'm getting stronger, and I'm doing another round of that thing because it was good for me. I didn't like it. I hated the exercise. I really did. I hated it. I was like, I got to do this again. And I got to post it on Facebook, just prove I did it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. I had to walk myself through it. And sometimes we're that way spiritually. We're like, oh, I hate that. No, pastor, don't talk about that. No, what? Drink it. No, I like my drink. I like my beer. Please don't talk about it. You're convicting me. I don't like it. And we don't like it. Our flesh doesn't like it. But you want to be sharp. Don't you want to be sharp? Don't you want to be spiritually in tune? Listen, you guys, it's a matter of life and death. Can be. A matter of life and death. Do you know how many people in 9/11, how many people did not go to work that day because they had something on the inside going, don't go to work today? They didn't know why. They didn't know the Twin Towers were going to have airplanes crash into them and they were going to drop to the ground. They didn't know that. They just had this little inkling on the inside, this little, no, don't go to church. Don't go to work today. Stay home. Huh? That doesn't make any sense. Why would I stay home? I just heard about somebody or read about somebody that didn't get on an airplane because they had that. And they're like, but I'm going to miss my next flight. I need to get on. And this something on the inside was like, no, don't get on this airplane. And lo and behold, that airplane crashed. There was a little boy one time. How many of you have ever heard of Keith Green? Older people. You older folks. Keith Green had a little three-year-old boy. How many of you know that three-year-olds are sensitive to the Spirit of God unless they're filled with a bunch of secular garbage? Don't put that in your little kids. They're sensitive. Their little spirits are sensitive. And his mom and him and his dad drove up to this little airplane. His dad was going to fly away, and the little boy, he got on the plane, and the plane took off, and the little boy turned to his mommy, and he said, "Mommy, why is Daddy going on that airplane? Doesn't he know it's going to crash?" And it did, and killed his dad and the pilot. That little boy was sensitive to the Spirit of God. And you and I need to be sensitive to the Spirit of God. Are you still with me? You want me to stop or go on? I know it's getting late. You want me to go on? Okay, let me give you another point. And I'll try and give them to you fast. Okay, so guide, I kind of said this already. The word guide is the Greek word hagio, and it's the word that is for a guide who shows a traveler the safest course through an unknown country. You know, we are walking in unknown territory sometimes. And that guide is living on the inside of you. Number four, instantly obey the voice of your spirit. Don't argue. When you get that little nudge on the inside, you know, this is what I do. When I'm praying and God starts giving me something, I ask him for scriptures to back up what he said to me. So he, you know, I'm praying, he gives me something and I write it all down. Then I'll say, okay, give me a scripture for that. And he will just drop a scripture in my heart that has to do with what he just said to me. It's a really good way to train yourself. I missed it many times before I started hitting the mark. Now I'm pretty accurate. When he says that to me, I'm pretty accurate. I still miss it every once in a while, but it's pretty accurate. When I hear him, I go look at it, and I'm like, and when it's right on, I'll say, wow, okay, give me another one. He'll give me another one. And then I'll say, oh, that's awesome, give me another one. He'll give me another one. I've gotten up to four. Boom, boom, boom. And it's all saying the same thing that he just spoke to me. A really good way to rain train you to do that. That's not hard. Amen? And then, I only have one more. I'm skipping all this. Jesus was led. We know that. Let me go down to this last point, because this is really important. And it's first, go to First Peter. And I could say a whole bunch more here, but part of you being trained is having a submitted heart. A submitted heart. So keep your heart submitted to God, to the Word of God, and to those that He has placed over you. And in that, this could be another point, stay humble. It's so easy for us to get full of pride and to think, oh, God spoke to me, and, you know, go flaunting that around. Well, you know what? The Holy Ghost will speak to you, and he will tell you things. He will show you things. He will show you things. I could tell you story after story of things that he showed me about my kids. And most of the time when he would show me, I would be like, what? He showed me pictures. He showed me living color. He showed me like a movie screen one time where I saw it, and I wasn't even thinking about them. I was on my way, this particular time, I was on my way to the hospital to help this woman deliver a baby. She was a single mom and asked me to come and be her coach. I was thinking about that, but I was praying in the Holy Ghost. And right before I got on Highway 26, right before I went through the tunnel, I see this live video feed in my spirit. Color, word, I heard it, I saw it, everything. Very clear and very accurate. It was about my kids. And if you're sensitive to God, he'll show you things about your kids so that you can go to them and you can help them. Not, I didn't fly off the handle, I didn't go nuts, I didn't scream and yell at them. I just said, this is what I saw. Is this what you did? Because they broke some rules. And you know, how many of you know that keeps your kids kind of in line when they have a fear of God, when God is showing mom and dad stuff about what they're doing? It helps. Amen. Wish I'd been more sensitive with some other situations that I wasn't. But some I was. I was very cued in on some. And I was a praying mom, and God would show me things, and he would lead me. And it brought it out in the open instead of these things that were hidden, where sin could come in, where damage could come in. He brought them out to the open so we could talk about it, we could pray about it, we could lay it out on the table and deal with it. Do you know how much better that is than things that are all hidden and sin and nobody seeing anything? The devil's involved in that. He always wants to hide things. God wants you to know things, but he doesn't want you flipping out about it. You have to be controlled. You have to be spirit-led, spirit-controlled when you're dealing with those things. And if you're not, then he probably isn't showing you things. If you're going to go nuts and crazy and, you know, he's not going to do that. If you can't be self-controlled, you have to be controlled. God will show you things, and then he'll show you how to deal with them. And it's awesome. I loved parenting that way. Oh, I wish I'd known earlier and done that more and been more sensitive. But now I'm helping you guys. Amen? You've got teenagers, you've got kids that you're kind of wondering, what exactly is going on? Pray. Seek God. Ask him what's going on here. And let him show you. Listen, your kids will straighten up real fast when they know God's watching. Because he is watching. They just don't know he's watching. But when he tells you, then they'll know. It's not something you make up. It's not something you fabricate. I got it. It's not something you fabricate. It's not something you make up. It's something that God reveals to you so that you can be a parent supernatural. A supernatural parent. Best kind of parenting there is. And a spirit-controlled parent. Amen? Did that help you tonight? Did you get something out of that? Okay, well, Pastor will clean it up tomorrow. Don't miss tomorrow, or next week. Don't miss tomorrow. Pastor's going to be teaching on end times, and it's going to be really good. Amen? You want to be here, bring your friends. Oh, he's going to